Honorable the Chief Justice, my senior colleague brother Justice Dharmadhikari, Advocate General Mr. Kumbakoni, Principal Secretary Law and Judiciary Mr. Dhote, my friends, good evening. I welcome the Honorable Chief Justice and Justice Dharmadhikari on this 30th Foundation Day of our Administrative Tribunal. When I went to give invitation to the Honorable Chief Justice, without any hesitation, my Lord accepted the invitation, and same is the case of Justice Dharmadhikari. Thank you very much. This shows their visit. It shows their concern about the working of this institution, our tribunal. Friends, 30 years is not a big span for any institution, but to sustain meaningfully and deliver the goods for the tribunal is a big thing for us. Every institution stands on the shoulders of forefathers. Today, we also express our gratitude towards our predecessors, the chairperson, earlier chairpersons, the members of the bar who have contributed in building this bar and the tribunal. We are thankful to the High Court for its guidance, and so also the government for its cooperation. It is the day we need to introspect for our future journey, especially on the background of judgment given by Orissa High Court, by upholding the decision of abolition of Administrative Tribunal of Orissa. It is our responsibility and duty to rise up to the expectations of the litigants, and so also rise to the object let down by in the judgment of L. Chandra Kumar and also Sampat Kumar. It's a servant and master relationship, and I completed 1 year here, but I found that psychology plays major role in the administration. So we have also tried sometimes practicing, introducing mediation under section 89 of CPC. It worked in some matters, it did not work in some. But we are trying, experimenting some different novel methods. There is a dual responsibility on us that we should really work as supplement to the High Court, and so also give justice, see that the justice is given to the litigants who are mainly the government servants, and similarly, we should not create any obstacle in the smooth functioning of the administration of the government. So it is a responsibility of our working bar and bench board, and we are working as a team throughout.
Good evening, Lordships. I request the Honorable Chairperson Madam to welcome the Honorable the Chief Justice with flowers. I request the Honorable Vice Chairman Shri Praveen Dixit to present bouquet to Honorable Justice Shri S.C. Dharmadhikari. My Lord, we have decided to felicitate the advocates who have been practicing in the tribunal from day one and continue till today. All these lawyers are very active today also. I request my lord to felicitate these 5 lawyers. Shri M. R. Patil. Shri Arvind Bandivedekar. Shri Ram Apte. Shri M.D. Lonkar. Shrimati Poonam Mahajan. I request my Lord Honorable Justice Shri S.C. Dharmadhikari to share his thoughts.
The Honorable Chief Justice, my esteemed colleague and Chairman Sister Mrudula Bhatkar, the Learned Advocate General, the Honorable Chairman, Vice Chairman, members of this tribunal, the president of the bar, the senior members of the bar, the officers and staff of the tribunal, and friends. I come here with mixed feelings. As Sister Mrudula Bhatkar reminded me of the 30 years of this tribunal, and she intended to invite me for today's function, I told her that I am a very poor substitute for my father. But since all of you remember him, it is my duty to come and attend today's function. Friends, while coming to this tribunal and then taking a round here, I was reminded of the day, and it's not a coincidence, when the then Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, who also happened to be from Calcutta, Chief Justice Chittatosh Mukherjee, called up my father and said, "Brother, you are well into your retirement, and it is a well deserved retirement, because you started your innings in 1954 and you stepped down in 1989. You want to go back and stay at Nagpur and be with your grandchildren?" He said that yes, because my both sons are still not married and I have not allowed them to appear in the court till I was a sitting judge. Very actively they were not practicing. So I had intended to step down after my not accept any office. But he said this is first time that the government is setting up a tribunal at the state level for about 7.5 lakh government employees. Their problems are immense and we are unable to cope up with their litigation. I do not wish to hand over this to anybody, and I have identified you, and will you turn down my request if I make you the same sincerely as a younger brother? Because Justice Chittatosh Mukherjee retired a year later. My father could not refuse, but it was a drastic change for him. We found that barely a vehicle could be arranged for carrying him from our home in Samta to Konkan Bhavan, where this tribunal worked in a very ramshackle place. There were no proper rooms, no proper lighting, no furniture. My father said, anyway, we take up this challenge. With just one or two members and some few staff, he took up the challenge and thereafter pursued the matter with the government. With great difficulty, the earlier premises at the barracks, you will all recollect, were made available. Thereafter, the staff, and then because of the volume of work, it was decided to set up benches at Nagpur and Aurangabad. He thought that the litigants should not be forced to travel. That time, this technology and all these advances were not made. The law was also developing, and till he was in charge, I could not see even the premises. I was not allowed to enter any of those places where the tribunal took seat, whether it Bombay or Nagpur or Aurangabad. After he retired, I could practice in this tribunal. But before that, I had some experience of practicing in the tribunal. My friend and senior colleague Atul Rajadhyaksha is here, and I am reminded of the days where Mr. Atul Settlewad, his senior, would appear before the tribunal, namely now known as SESTAT, at the Firozshah Mehta Road. And I would find that tribunal to be most competent, most professional. And I would find there all these stalwarts appearing. I would go out sometimes, brief them, and appear also in independent matters. And I found that not only the bar was gaining in confidence, but with them the technical members were more judicious in their approach than the judicial members. We found that it was so competently handled, there was nothing like an adjournment. The note was put and you would get a date for admission. If you want an urgent relief, you have to put another note. It used to be scanned, and thereafter a date earlier would be given for some interim orders. But on the date on which you go, your matter would be definitely taken up. If you do not want to argue that matter on that date, in advance you had to intimate, one adjournment was permissible. On the next date, if you don't turn up, they would decide the case, and they would decide it sometimes in your favor also. Such was the competence and the level there that I found that the same should be the approach even for the Central Administrative Tribunal. Some of our retired judges went to the Central Administrative Tribunal and I used to appear there. Friends, those were very tough days. You would not remember, but sometimes I also recollect when original suits were transferred. It was such a task for us, convincing the tribunal that you will have to record evidence. They would say, no, Evidence Act doesn't apply. Civil Procedure Code does not apply. Then I had to tell them that maybe there are rules which are there in the Act, but the evidence will still apply, the principles will apply. What is not evidence cannot be taken on record at all. And there you will have to, either by way of affidavit, take the examination in chief, and if I have a contest, I must be allowed to cross-examine. It was difficult convincing them, oh, officers of the government, you want to cross-examine? I said, if they depose from the record, and they have deposed from the record, but I find that the record speaks otherwise, I will have to cross-examine. And those were the days where we had to, as members of the bar, tell them that this is how matters are judicially decided. There is a difference between you deciding matters as an administrator in Mantralaya or in your secretariat and as judges here. You would have to go by some rules, some practices, some very healthy traditions, and at the bar as well as at the bench. Sometimes our own ex-judges, and I have seen this in this tribunal. I recollect one day where there was a bench, but the member, administrative member in the bench, was least interested in what was going on. He said, "I have seen the file." So then I had to very politely tell him, "Sir, you are not supposed to see any files from Mantralaya or from your secretariat. You are supposed to consider only these files in which there are pleadings, there are affidavits, and those are based on the record." "No, but I have the habit. I can call up the government office and ask for the files." I said, "You are not supposed to do that. If you have deposed on the before the tribunal on oath and that is based on record, you are not supposed to carry something else to your chamber and show it to you privately." He said, "What is wrong in that?" I said, "Everything is wrong in that. You can't do this and decide these matters, because what comes naturally to us is natural justice. Justice is ingrained in the system, be it in the tribunal or be it in the court of law. That is precisely why when tribunalization of justice has come, people are thinking that you are not dispensing justice, but dispensing with justice. Friends, we will have to create an atmosphere so that this impression goes. And this impression can go when we handle everything very professionally. Professionally means competently and equally ethically. That is the hallmark of the bar, which when it was before the court, the same discipline has to be maintained. Our seniors at the bar used to say, "You strive hard, you work hard, you make the judge read. You make him work. How dare he does not work? How dare he does not read? Tell him to pick up the file and read." And we, my senior friends here, they are all with senior to me, but we are together for decades. And we have seen judges and judges, and we have seen members and members here as well. They were no different when they came here. They were no different when they were there. The files would come down straight and we would tell them to pick them up. They had to pick them up. And when they were convinced, they would pass orders. And we would help them to pass orders in accordance with law. We were not worried whether they were against us or whether they were passed in favor of somebody. Being independent and impartial doesn't mean pro or anti-government. There is this impression created everywhere that the more you decide matters against the state or the government, the more independent and impartial you are. That's not how we judge things. We decide things on the basis that a bad case is disposed of, dismissed, it is doing justice. But in those borderline cases where we have to appreciate that there is something like failure of justice, there is miscarriage of justice because people are not seeing this day in and day out in the secretariat. In the closed chambers, you don't see how justice is done. Justice is not seen to be done there. It is in the court that it is seen to be done. And that is where we tell them that be patient, hear us. You may ultimately decide, but you must see both the case of the petitioners and the respondents. Read and read with us. Sometimes we may not be able to trace out the correct statutory position or the legal position. Then it is your duty. You must not pass orders hastily. There is a case which has to be decided, and disposing of is not decision making. You have to decide cases, and decision takes time as well. And sometimes you have to take matter again when we are completely closed. And it used to happen, and it must happen because of a lot of pressure of work in Bombay. And I am no exception, I can tell you. Sometimes you have to have that. When my father was a judge, there was nothing like Aurangabad bench of this court, high court. There used to be only Nagpur and Bombay. Goa was added, we were a common High Court. Goa was not state that time. And my friends would recollect, I would never go in his courtroom. But what my work was, I can tell you, when I was a law student, is to when he used to come back from his walk in Nariman Point and ask me whether the whole file, set of files have come. Yeah, I would say yes. And my mom would say, don't tell him that they have come because he will not eat anything. I had to tell him, I said, he is such a person, he will trace out for himself. So I would put one condition. I will lay the whole files for you. You eat because you have come back from a walk and you are a diabetic. So you are supposed to eat. So first eat, and I would lay all the files. Would come the bare acts, only the bare acts. Hardly any case law, because case law, the books had to be brought, and books were at our place. We brought the library from Nagpur when my father came here in 1977, but not the whole library. Half of it was on his fingertips, so he never required. It was that after he was completely told to eat something and eat, did he, then the files were laid, my real work would start. That he would say, oh, you are such a dud, how will you do law? You would not be able to trace out that book. Bring the 46 Privy Council. All Privy Council volumes were there. And I did not know where they were kept. Then I would go searching for the sepoy. He said, he has gone home. I have sent him back. You have to trace out. And those files, those books, and completely till that time, there was somebody who came and told him that there is dinner laid. He would read. And read and make notes as well. Friends, sometimes he would not narrate, but his colleague judges would tell my mom and myself, your father today disposed of 180 matters and he looks as fresh as anybody, and here he makes me work. I don't want to sit with him next time. He used to say next. Jocularly they would all say this. But it was such a tough task that time, and tough ask on a judge with hardly 4-digit salary, no vehicle provided, nothing, no typewriters as well. Today we have everything at our disposal. Then what are we worried? We are not able to deliver quality justice is the complaint. Why that quality is going down? That is something which I always say has to be given prominence. If you are not able to do and achieve that, no amount of filings and disposals and institution figures will impress anybody. It is the quality of the justice that has to be kept in the forefront. Somewhere down the line, we have forgotten. Everybody who talks and speaks the least, even from the bench or the bar, achieves the best results. If you do not find your names in the newspaper, that means you are working. That was how we, all the judges that time. And why are we today worried and we get bogged down by several things? We should not get bogged down by all these irrelevant and extraneous things. What we have to decide are cases, and cases according to the pleadings and the law. But what is happening is we depend too much on assistance from the bar. In these tough times, in the times of corona and all this epidemic, we are now becoming extra dependent on technology or assistance from the advocates. It is this time we must utilize to update everything. Today everything is available on the tip. We have the online digests, we have everything. That time we all were finding it extremely difficult and could not even afford to buy books. There was one or two libraries in the High Court building, but we could not, all of us, lay our hands to the books that we needed. Yet the disposal never suffered. Today we must strive to bring those days back. The tribunal is something which, as the Supreme Court says, will replace or substitute the traditional courts is the feeling, but actually they supplement them. They are not going to create a vacuum in the court. So why should we feel, oh, this litigation is gone, oh, that litigation is gone? Why I am saying this, please don't misunderstand. when we had the original site full, complete full, with bank suits and everything, came a day when a parliamentary committee came to the High Court, all these chartered High Courts and others, they came to commercial capital, obviously. And we could not say, please don't come to the bar, please don't come to see our working. All of them came, they discussed, and before they disbursed, it was good 2 or 3 hours discussion. And they said, sir, it's a very sorry thing. You can't dispose of a bank suit for 10 years or 15 years when there is no defense. There is no denial of the transaction, there is no denial of the contract. The man is saying, I do not know the bank. Now, these sort of written statement with evasive denials, and yet the suit remains pending for 20 years. Then the appeals, then the execution. Why shouldn't we take away this jurisdiction from you? We fought and fought. Writ petition was filed all over India. But ultimately, the decision went in favor of creation of the tribunals. Why did this happen? It was a specialized tribunal for the tax matters, for the indirect taxes. We did not complain because that was absolutely specialized field. When it came to all these ordinary matters, the civil court jurisdiction going away, that we started complaining. These service matters, the same thing happened. Until we were told that a person suffers also because of being in suspension, no inquiry held. Suspension becomes a suspension punishment. And punishment as suspension is different. Punishment in the punishment rule, where you give a punishment as suspension, that's a different thing, that's post-inquiry. But when you suspend before inquiry and keep him pending, that inquiry pending, he suffers. Public interest suffers. You have to pay subsistence allowances. Lakhs and crores of rupees go down the drain. And these matters are not decided by you. You have not been able to decide the matters relating to transfers, the postings, because of that suffer, the promotions, and several other things. And we all know how far we used to go and argue cases, especially when the members of our bench were from the district judiciary. We thought, oh, we've got a judge who will now at least hear, even if it is something which is so settled, still we would argue. And those direct recruits and quota rules and all those matters, again and again, they went up to Supreme Court, got decided finally. But someday that litigation would end. It has still not ended. All these matters therefore required some attention. Even this jurisdiction went away from the High Court. The resistance grew, but we have to accept this. The challenge by Madras Bar Association won twice, thrice in the Supreme Court, even one pending now. What did the Supreme Court tell you? They tell you that it is nothing but a substitute, but a meaningful substitute where independence, impartial, and justice with integrity and absolute caliber is going to be assured to you. Mind you, do not fight and resist their creation. Cooperate so that they work efficiently. That is how the Supreme Court judgments are carved out. Today we find that we still go on resisting. We go on resisting about the tenure. We go on resisting about service conditions. We challenged the rules in that behalf. How far can we go? Now the Supreme Court appeals to the members of the bar. And this is how I conclude. Younger members of the bar now must come forward to take over and preside these benches. If you do not accept any of these positions, it will not be possible to make full appointments, to find out persons post-retirement, or to find out persons in district judiciary post their retirement, or members of the administration. Is extremely difficult. It's not an easy task. The Chief Justice and others are endowed with that task, but he has multiple tasks. How far can he go and give you time? It is ultimately the members of the bar who will make a court or a bench. We must come forward and take over this responsibility. This is a duty. And if the call is for duty, performing this duty, kindly don't refuse. Hereafter, the service conditions and everything are going to be improving. There is an assurance coming in every matter which goes to the Supreme Court in with regard to these tribunal rules that the matters will improve, the Supreme Court will intervene. You will recollect the day when Sampath Kumar virtually rewrote the Administrative Tribunal Act. Justice Bhagwati took it upon himself and with minute details he went through the law and said this is, should be there, this should not be there. Thereafter came a scenario where the quality deteriorated, therefore the Chandra Kumar principle came. Otherwise from here directly to Supreme Court, and I have taken matters from Central Administrative Tribunal to Supreme Court and from Administrative Tribunal, the Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal when I started practicing, to the Supreme Court. And they would be extremely happy, they were reluctant to interfere in some of the very good orders. And some of the very good orders were written by administrative members. So it is not as if when we start practicing before this tribunal and gain this experience that it has to be wasted. If some of us can still contribute, we must take up that responsibility. And friends, I have taken too much of your time. I would only request all of you that if this tribunal and all tribunals with its benches have to prosper, to deliver justice and quality justice, it will have to be with your hard work. Thank you.
Thank you, Lordship. We are eager to hear the Honorable the Chief Justice. Hence, I request your Lordship to enlighten us.
Sister Justice Bhatkar, respected judicial and administrative members of the Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal, my elder brother, Justice Dharmadhikari, Mr. Kumbhakoni, Advocate General, Mr. Sakre, Mr. Dhakefalkar, Mr. Rajadaksha, Mr. Desai, yes, covered face. I had the occasion to see Mr. Desai without the mask because during the first year he was having the most appearances before my court. Mr. Apte, other senior members of the bar of the tribunal, junior members, members of the staff, Mr. Dhote, my new law and judiciary secretary, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed an honor and pride to be associated with the 30th birthday of the Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal. And it is also a privilege for me to address you all because after coming to Bombay in April 2020, this is my first function which I am attending physically. Although with Mr. Dhakefalkar, I have crossed swords at Wankhede Stadium. Now, before I proceed on to make on my points, I would like to respond to Brother Justice Dharmadhikari. His Lordship has said that His Lordship is a poor substitute of Justice C.S. Dharmadhikari. Well, I have not seen Justice C.S. Dharmadhikari function in court, but I have seen the judgments and orders authored by Justice S.C. Dharmadhikari. And I would say it would be desirable for any judge to emulate His Lordship. The industry that is behind the judgments authored by His Lordship is commendable. His Lordship is, I would say the judgments are a bit lengthy, but you don't lose track, you don't lose continuity. It's not that something has been extracted from here or there. There is a continuity, and while one studies the judgment, one can assess, one can evaluate the tremendous effort that is put behind every judgment. So, sir, I respectfully disagree that, right. Now, Justice Dharmadhikari has shared his experiences during the formative days of the tribunal. He has traced the history of the Tribunals Act. One very important point that has been made by His Lordship is that there is a growing concern of tribunalization of justice. And many people think that it is not dispensing justice, but dispensing with justice. Well, this concern is there. I would go a step ahead. People say it is trivialization of justice. Standing here as the Chief Justice, I would not go further so far as the working of the other tribunals which have been constituted under the different enactments. But so far as the administrative tribunal here, the little experience that I have had over the last 15 months, because I have been taking up the writ petitions against the tribunal's orders, as well as my experience that I bring from another chartered high court to another chartered high court, is that the state administrative tribunals as well as the central administrative tribunals have been doing a commendable job. And apart from appreciating the efforts of the members, I would also appreciate the efforts of the members of the bar who really assist us in delivering justice. You know, many a time we are given the credit that so-and-so judge has laid down the law for the first time. Where does the judge get the material from? The material is given by you all. You interpret a statute and you tell us, sir, this is the proper way to interpret a statute, and then we lay down the law. The credit comes to us, but the credit should ideally go to you all. Now, so far as the role of the tribunals constituted in furtherance of Article 323 capital A are concerned, my lord is again right. They play a supplemental role to the judicial review powers of the Supreme Court and the High Courts in service matters. And the jurisdiction is wide. As held in L. Chandra Kumar, the tribunal can even test the vagaries of a legislation. Except, of course, the act that creates it, that is the Administrative Tribunals Act. And while discharging its functions, the tribunal considers the entire gamut of service law in relation to public employment. Now, what is this public service law? It is a combination of statutory rules as well as departmental instructions in the form of published and unpublished circulars, notes, letters, and clarifications. When I used to practice service matters and used to go to the tribunals in Calcutta, I felt lost in this jungle of departmental instructions, this uncodified law. Therefore, it is for us, the lawyers, who have been practicing before the tribunals, to equip us, the judges on the other side, so that we do not miss a point. We are not accused of delivering judgments which are either sub silentio or per incurium judgments. Now, it's a very difficult task. We don't get the departmental instructions readily, those who appear for the employees. Now, here I would like to impress upon the members of the tribunal that please consider whether you can rely on any unpublished departmental instruction, because the law is, if you want somebody to be governed by a set of rules, those rules should be published so that he gets to know what is required of him. If you don't publish it, he doesn't get to know what is required of him, and thereafter you cannot take action against him based on such unpublished materials. Now, so far as the tribunal's other considerations are concerned, you know, we have to see it from a broader perspective, that you deal with matters which start with creation of a relationship and terminates with the end of relationship. And in between, you deal with so many matters. I was just trying to find out if one would try to make a topic of the matters. Recruitment, reservation, retirement, these are with R. With P, you have probation, pay, promotion, proceedings, pension, you have seniority, you have transfer, posting, deputation, leave, ACRs, allowances, re-employment. Whole set of matters. People who don't practice service law would sometimes tell me, what is there in service law? You know, it's only precedent based. But there's much more than what precedents are. So therefore, these things have to be kept in mind while the tribunal members discharge their functions and while they apply the established principles of law to new situations. Now, we know that constitutionality, consistency and certainty in decisions constitute a sound judiciary. This obviates confusion and upholds the rule of law. But at the same time, you know, we notice inconsistencies, contradictions, and even to the extent of absurdities, while our higher courts as well as the high courts interpret judgments which are there already in the field. We all have to be very careful about this. I'll give an instance. You all know about Managing Director ECIL versus B. Karunakar. What was the point referred to the Constitution bench? Whether before a punishment is ordered pursuant to a disciplinary inquiry, the delinquent is entitled to the report of inquiry. This was the only point that was referred. Now, this was answered in the affirmative that yes, report constitutes a material which has to be given, otherwise he doesn't know what material is being considered behind his back. While answering the basic question which was referred to the Supreme Court, there were six other incidental questions. And one of the incidental questions towards the later part was, what is to be done with those cases which are pending before the High Courts and the Supreme Court, where the inquiry report is not given to the delinquent? So there the Supreme Court said, you know, we will not mechanically set aside the orders of punishment only on the ground that the report has not been given. We will ask the employee to show what is the prejudice suffered by him. So far, so good. Absolutely clean judgment delivered by Justice Sawant. Later on, what happens? Whenever matters are before the High Court or before the Supreme Court, we get judgments that, yes, admitted, you have not been given the inquiry report. Show the prejudice you have suffered. My question is, my respectful question is, where is the question of the prejudice being shown? Why shouldn't the court ask the employer, why didn't you follow the mandate of the Constitution bench and give the report? What is the answer to that? There may be cases where the employer may say that I have tried my best to give the report, I could not find out. Those are exceptions. But what we do is, we don't ask the employer why the report has not been given. We go to the concluding part of the judgment and see that, oh, this is what has been laid down, prejudice has to be proved. Well, this is undermining the rule of law. This is violating the ratio of the decision in Karunakar. So my request to you all members of the bar would be, you have an onerous responsibility. We as judges, you know, we are bound by our pressures, judicial pressures, administrative pressures. But it is for you all to read the entire judgment. Don't go by the head notes. Read the entire judgment and tell the judge that, look, sir, this is the ratio. An answer to an incidental question is not the ratio of the judgment. That is the part of the judgment which would cater to the needs of the people who are before the court at that relevant point of time. Let me give you another instance. This is pertaining to recruitment. We try to, let us be very frank, sir, we try to look for shortcuts, you know, so that we don't have to deliver big judgments. Petition is dismissed. So when a recruitment process is challenged, the state comes up with a plea. You have participated in the process without raising any objection. You can't challenge. Wonderful. My participation in the process results in forfeiture of my right to challenge a process. There are n number of cases starting from Om Prakash Shukla to Madan Lal to Chandra Prakash Tiwari to Manish Sahi all. It is for you to find out what is the distinctive feature. You will have to tell the court that, sir, I have participated in the process without knowledge. Without knowledge of the vitiating factor. How could I know it? Let us take an example. Somebody is employed, selected and employed. I later on apply under the RTI Act. I find out that he did not have the basic qualification. Am I precluded from taking a challenge to his appointment that he does not conform to the rules, conform to the advertisement? There is a time limit within which applications are to be filed. If somebody does not file that application within time, but even then there is somebody in the employer's roster, by reason of favoritism, he is given the employment. Am I precluded from challenging? So therefore, it is your duty to tell us that this is the feature which distinguishes Madan Lal, Om Prakash and other lot of cases. Third example, you know, these are coming. All these cases come before us. After retirement, efforts are made by the employer to deduct from the retirement benefits. Why? You have been paid in excess of your entitlement while you were in service. Now there was Shyam Babu Verma, there was Abdul Qadir, there was B.J. Akkara, all these decisions. Then came Chandi Prasad Unnial. What did it say? These are all judgments having regard to the facts of the case. There cannot be unjust enrichment. It is public money. If you have been paid in excess of your entitlement, you have no right to retain it. Right? Chandi Prasad Unnial is considered in first Rafiq Masi case. It goes before a three-judge bench. What does the three-judge bench say? It says, Chandi Prasad Unnial is law declared under 136 read with 141. Shyam Babu, Akkara, Qadir, etc., etc. are all 142. Matter goes back to the division bench. Please read the judgment. You will not find a single reference to the three-judge bench judgment. Again, law laid down. C, D, nothing doing. 1 year or 5 years, whatever it is. 5 years, no deduction. Well, do we serve society in this way? Therefore, these are just instances where we also, we are judges, but we are all human beings. Please remember that. To err is human. Therefore, it is your duty as members of this noble profession to guide us so that we can deliver justice to the people. After all, in a tribunal like this, you know, the employees come. The employer is always against him. Madam, you are the presenting officer. You have a duty towards the tribunal court. You have a duty towards your client, that is government, but also a duty towards your citizen. If you find, or other presenting officers who are here, if you find that somebody has been denied his benefit, it is for you to address the court and say that this is what is the position. We feel that this has been unjustly denied. Right? My Lord Justice Dharmadhikari hinted about judicial independence, that if a member of the tribunal delivers judgments against government, he is regarded as an anti-establishment judge. I am absolutely at idem with His Lordship that there is nothing as independent judge. We all deliver according to the oath that we have taken, without fear or favor, affection or ill will. If a case has merit, we grant the relief. If a case does not have merit, it is dismissed. There is no question of judge becoming independent only because he delivers against the government. No. Government is only a client. A client to the lawyer, litigant before us. There is nothing of that sort. I'll just end with one assurance to all of you. When I was in Calcutta, you know, there also the tribunal members were selected on the basis of recommendations made by the High Court. And the practice was that the J1 was the head of the committee. So I was the J1 in Calcutta High Court for a very short period, about 3 or 4 months. But during that period, I had to chair certain sessions. So I said, tribunal members were being appointed. We don't have that here in Maharashtra. There is a land reforms tribunal in Calcutta, which caters to the entire of West Bengal, constituted under 323B. Now, we had names of administrative members to be appointed, all serving members of the bureaucracy. So the committee consisted of myself as chairperson, the chief secretary, and the land reforms department secretary. So the first meeting, the chief secretary came with a file, gave it to me and said, sir, we have selected, this is the gentleman who may be appointed as the administrative member. I said, who are you to select, Mr. Chief Secretary? I believe the law says there should be a selection committee which will select. So I am the chairperson of the selection committee. Whoever is willing to offer his candidature will have to appear for an interactive session with me. Sir, what are you saying? This will create a very bad precedent. All other judges henceforth will be doing this. I said, what do you mean by transparency in selection process? You know, it's another thing that the gentleman who was selected by the chief secretary, he was really good and I also agreed that he should be. But I have been continuing the same process here. Madam Gadgil is here. She would, you know, she is proof of the circumstance that even she had to face a grilling session from us. I was there, CS was there, Madam was there, and MPSC chairman was there. We handpick the members. The best talent we get, we will do it. And we would encourage all the members of the bar, those who are interested, to put in your application so that we can consider you, because you are also entitled to function as judicial member. Isn't it? But we didn't get too many applications from the members of the bar, right? So therefore, this is the request that I would make to you. And I'll conclude by borrowing an observation from a speech delivered by a judge of the Madhya Pradesh High Court. I had been to Jabalpur some time back, and in course of his address, he told us one thing, which I feel that it's absolutely 200% correct. He said, whatever is put across to us is a file for us, F-I-L-E, file for us, but it is life for the litigant. You know, it is our duty to save the life. Thank you very much.
On behalf of Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal, as well as the Advocates Association of Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal, I thank Honorable the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court and Justice Dharmadhikari for gracing the occasion of 30th Foundation Day of Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal. I also thank Honorable the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court for delivering an insightful lecture on service law, service jurisprudence, and especially, in fact, the tips what he had given to the petitioners, advocates, in fact, what we are listening to the Honorable Chief Justice just now. Though MAT is an institution established 30 years ago, however, the service jurisprudence in India relates to the Manusmritis, that is 3rd century BC. Then Yajnavalkya Smriti, 1st century AD. Narada Dharma Shastras, 1st to 3rd century AD. And many other smritis. So, we can proudly say that administrative law and service jurisprudence has a long Indian heritage, and it cannot be said that it is a recently developed branch of law. Sir, after the establishment of this tribunal, we were given the premises in government barracks near Mantralaya, as Jashi Dharmadhikari just now said. However, due to the construction of metro project, we have been temporarily shifted to these premises, but we are hopeful that as per the orders passed by the Honorable Bombay High Court, we will be relocated in our previous premises as soon as the construction of metro project is completed. I would also like to mention about the order passed by Justice Dharmadhikari, that is the division bench of Justice Dharmadhikari, by which the government suggested, the government was suggested to enhance the jurisdiction of Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal by incorporating under its purview service matters of the employees working in municipal corporations, councils, Jilla Parishads and government undertakings, as has been done by the central government in respect of Central Administrative Tribunal. I once again thank, I would once again like to reiterate my request on behalf of Bar to the Honorable Chief Justice, is that as has been done in case of Central Administrative Tribunal, the jurisdiction of MAT be enhanced, and the other municipal corporations, municipal councils, Jilla Parishads, their service matters may also be, in fact, taken under the purview of this Honorable Tribunal.
Don't make a request to me. It is for him.
Law secretary, yes. So, I once again thank the Honorable Chief Justice of Bombay High Court and Justice Dharmadhikari for enlightening the bar on the new dimensions of functioning of tribunal, dispensation of justice in tribunal. I also thank the Advocate General of Maharashtra, Shashwat Kumbhakoni, the senior advocates of Bombay High Court, and as well as our Law Secretary Mr. Dhote for gracing the function by the valuable presence. I also thank the reporters who have attended today's function, and I thus declare that the function is over. Now, considering the COVID situation, a special arrangement of high tea has been made for the dignitaries in the court hall number 1. The members of the bar are requested to be seated, and a refreshment will be served on their seats. Thank you.